Yo, champs in the making, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year! It's been more than a month since I last posted a Nuzlocke, but worry no more, because Tarmeister is back with the hardest Nuzlocke on this channel so far. Welcome to my Christmas and year-end special, which is a Pokemon Renegade Platinum Hardcore Nuzlocke using only water Pokemon. Now, you might be wondering, what's the connection between this Nuzlocke and Christmas? First, Christmas is typically known for its winter feel if you're living in the Northern Hemisphere, so Sinnoh is the perfect region to play on. And since Christmas is the birthday of Jesus, I chose Monotype Water as a theme because water symbolizes birth. Furthermore, Jesus is also known for walking on water, turning water into wine and being the water of life. And having the mission of saving us from all sins, it's fitting to beat a game whose mascot is a Pokemon's version of Satan. There you go! I tried my best to make this as Christmas-themed as possible, but in reality, I just wanted to play a Monotype Nuzlocke on an enhanced ROM hack because I've never seen one on YouTube. So, religious classes out of the way, the complete rules for this Nuzlocke are found in the description below. But to summarize, I can only catch the first water Pokemon that I encounter in each specific area. When a Pokemon faints, it is considered dead and must be permanently boxed. The Nuzlocke should be played on set mode. Bag items are not permitted during battles, but hell items are allowed. No overleveling past the highest leveled Pokemon of the gym leader or elite four member, but overleveling during the battle is allowed. And of course, I should nickname every member of the team. Shoutout to Roberts and Do Things Different for being the first ones to guess the game and theme of this hardcore Nuzlocke. Both of them make amazing content on YouTube, so I recommend you to subscribe to their channels. The links are in the description below. So if you want to be featured in my videos, make sure to watch out for my community posts and comment right away. So sit back, relax, and enjoy, and if you do, consider giving this video a thumbs up, it helps out a lot. Also, before anything else, don't forget to subscribe and hit the notification bell for more fun content. And since I wish not to prolong your agony, let's find out if we can beat the first ever hardcore Nuzlocke on Pokemon Renegade Platinum using only water Pokemon. I named my rival Dry, and while visiting his house, his dad Palmer was there. Anyways, after getting reprimanded by Professor Rowan, it's time to choose the starter of this long Nuzlocke. So I chose the penguin Pokemon, Piplup, as Dry chose Turtwig. We used Growl twice, and they used Withdrawal once. Then we started spamming Tackles, which have perfect accuracy in this game, and Bubble, whose base power was boosted to 40. Luckily, no crits happened, so we managed to win the battle. I named my Piplup Mary. She's got the serious nature and the torrent ability. Next, I picked up this Eevee, which my mom has been taking care of. I named him John, and he's got the runaway ability and the jolly nature, which is one of the worst natures for a Vaporeon. In Lake Verity, I made my first catch and added Thomas the Surskit to my team. He's got the gentle nature and the swift swim ability. I then headed north, where instead of teaching us how to catch a Pokemon, Dawn challenged us to a battle. But since she has a Chimchar against my Piplup, then it was an easy battle of spamming bubbles. Soon after, I reached Jubilife City, and the first thing I did was to take the old rod from the fisherman in the left gate. He even gave me some dive balls. En route to 1-9, I caught a Horsea with Swift Swim and a bashful nature who I named Peter. In Jubilife City, there's this news reporter who asks you a series of questions. If you get them all right, she battles you. And if you beat her, she gives you all three of the Kanto starters. So, after sweeping her level 5 team with my level 10 Thomas, Squirtle, who I named Timothy, joined the gang. He's got the calm nature and the rainish ability, which is awesome because as soon as he evolves into Blastoise, his ability will turn into Drizzle. In the trainer school, there's an NPC who gives out a Pokemon egg, and the only viable encounter I can get there are Azurill and Mantyke. So I walked for a short while, and it's a Cleffa. I gave Dry the town map that his mom entrusted me to deliver. Then I continued to fish for more encounters. On Route 204, I caught Joanna the Magikarp, who has a Swift Swim ability and the modest nature. And on Route 218, I added Aquila the Finneon to my team, who's got the Swift Swim ability and the timid nature. And after a little bit of grinding, I headed east where a rival Dry awaits. I've seen many people wipe out to this battle because he's got a freaking Munchlax in his team who can tank hits and strike hard. Dry led with Starly as I sent in Aquila. Mystic Water means that Aquila will be able to 2-hit KO the Starly, so we absorbed the wing attack and killed them with a couple of water pulses. Next is sent in his Turtwig, and every single one of my Pokemon dies to a crit with Razor Leaf, so the best play here was to lower its attack with Charm and hope they don't crit. But yeah, in the first turn, they crit us, and thus we experience the first death of this run. So Timothy, who thankfully has Hidden Power Fire, knew he had to avenge his fallen brother. We brought them to a little more than half health, but they just went for curse. We then brought them back to the red as they ate their orange berry and went for another curse. Surprisingly, Dry used his potion, so the next turn I brought them to above half health again. And in the following turn, we again brought them back to the red as they missed their Razor Leaf. That was insanely huge for us. This allowed Timothy to kill the Turtwig and be at full health when the Munchlax came in. Water Pulse didn't do much, but Tackle did so much damage. Their second Tackle then crit, so next turn I switched to Peter. The same thing happened. We spammed Water Pulse, but this time they used Rock Tomb. This continued until we're low on health. I even risked a crit on the last turn. I sent in Mary, whose Water Pulse managed to crit, finally taking down the Munchlax. That was stressful. I continued east and caught Barnabas the Bidoof with a lonely nature and a simple ability. In Arborg City, we beat the reporter again, and this time she gave us the Hoenn starters. So, let's welcome Silas the Mudkip to our team. He's got the brave nature and the Tauren ability. Next, I went inside Arborg Mine, where Rourke gifted us the Waterstone, so I evolved John into Vaporeon. During the grinding process, Barnabas evolved into B-Barrel, Mary evolved into Prinplop, Timothy evolved into Wartortle, I killed a shiny Diglett, and Silas evolved into Marshtomp. And now, it's time to take on the first gym of this enhanced ROM hack. But with our water types, we could easily defeat the rock gym, right? We'll see. I led with Silas against Nosepass because their only attacking move is Shockwave, which we're immune to. They tried to set up a Sandstorm, but two Water Pulses just killed it. Next was a Geodude. Dead. Third was a Cranidos. And while it did a good chunk of damage with Zen Headbutt, Muscle Band boosted Bulldoze just KO'd it. Fourth was a Bonsly, and I used Water Pulse because it has a lower special defense stat than defense. Forgetting it gets a special defense boost from the Sandstorm. They just used Stealth Rock, so another Water Pulse just killed it. Fifth was the Onix. They managed to do some damage with Bulldoze, but they succumbed to a single Water Pulse. Last was a Larvitar. Worried about our health, I switched to Timothy as I uselessly went for Protect. Flame Orb triggers its Guts ability, so now this Larvitar just became dangerous. But Timothy just crit his Water Pulse, so that was the first gym. We were a little overleveled for this galactic battle, so we just breezed through it and ventured north and into the Ravaged Path. There, I caught Martha the Barboach, who's got the Quiet Nature and the Oblivious ability. As soon as I reached the Floa Roman Town, I immediately battled the news reporter to get our final set of starters. I added Best Boy Luke the Totodile with a hardy nature into my team. Besides gaining the dark type upon evolution, Totodile can have Intimidate as his ability, and I'm super excited about it. But it's Tauren. Anyways, I went to the Valley Windworks where I fished for Nicodemus the Shelder, who's got the relaxed nature and the incredible Shell Armor ability, which will prove to be one of the best abilities in the game. While grinding for the next fight, Joanna finally evolved into Gyarados. I also checked this honey tree where, unlike in the original games, you don't have to wait for 6 hours for a Pokemon to spawn. And furthermore, Munchlax now has a 10% chance of appearing. And it always holds leftovers. So what I did was use Covet on a wild Munchlax to steal the lefties and did it 6 more times and got myself 7 leftovers for the entirety of the game. Soon after, I battled what is generally described as the hardest part of the early game, Mars. Her team is buffed and her Poroglie now has Facade and Hypnosis. But with the right team, she can be handled pretty easily, at least from Renegade Platinum standards. First, I sent in Peter, who's holding an expert belt against a Zubat. Aurora Beam managed to Oko as she sent in Yanma. Right off the bat, they went for Detect, which allowed them to get a speed boost from their speed boost ability. I then risked a crit as Yanma outsped and went for Silver Wind. It did more than half health as her Aurora Beam brought them to the red. Next, I sent in Barnabas who can tank their moves. After getting stalled by a turn of Detect, we revenge killed them with the Aqua Jet. Third was a Bronzor. We yawned them to sleep as they hit us with extra sensory. We then went for Aqua Jet to buy some time. When Bronzor was finally asleep, I switched to Timothy to kill the Bronzor with a couple of hidden powers. Last was a Poroglie, and I have a foolproof plan against this Pokemon. First, I sent in Joanna to lower its attack with Intimidate. Then I switched back and forth between John and Joanna. Leftovers allowed us to take more turns of Intimidate. We managed to bring them down to minus 5 attack until Poroglie finally hit a crit against Joanna. I'm pretty sure there was a high roll crit though. And with everything set in place, I sent my trump card Nicodemus, who set up a few turns of withdrawal until we reached the point where the damage dealt by Poroglie's facade was just recovered by leftovers. Shell armor meant that we could never be crit, so a few bubble beams later, Mars was finally defeated. I forgot to catch my encounter in Route 205, so Priscilla the Chinchou joined my team. She's got the serious nature and the water absorb ability. I really wish she had Volt Absorb instead. On the way to Eterna City, I kill a shiny Mareep and went inside Eterna Forest. Spread around the Sinnoh region are what we call stat trainers, who specialize in one or two of the six Pokemon stats. In Vanilla Platinum, they serve as a guide throughout your journey. But in Renegade Platinum, they also battle you to make sure that you're strong enough to travel with them. First was the HP stat trainer, Cheryl. I led with Silas against Drifloon. And after tanking an ominous wind, a couple of rock tombs took it down. Next was Chansey. Stab Hyper Voice didn't do much as we 2-hit KO'd it with Bulldoze after Cheryl tried to heal. Third was Wailmer. We tanked a couple of Water Pulses, but 3 Bulldozes were enough for the win. Last was Makuhita. Since we're low on health, I switched to Joanna for the Intimidate, used Water Pulse just to check for its damage, and finish it off with Bounce. Upon reaching Eterna City, I fished for Dorcas the Poliwag. Drizzling Politoed is here, boys. Oh, it's damp. And the quirky nature. In Renegade Platinum, we are first required to go fetch Gardenia in Route 216 before battling her. So we went inside Mount Coronet where Phoebus is a 100% fishing encounter. I named her Phoebe and she's got the sassy nature and the Marvel scale ability. After picking up Gardenia, I went back to the old chateau to catch Salome the Rotom, who's got the very ideal bold nature and the levitate ability. I also evolved Thomas into Masquerain, changing its ability to Intimidate. Now it's time to challenge Gardenia. As a water type expert, I was super scared of this battle. I had doubts on starting this run because I might just end up getting swept by Gardenia. But anyways, this was how the seemingly most dreadful battle went. I led with Joanna against Blossom. Predicting a stun spore, I used Substitute, but they used Grass Knot, destroying the sub. I again went for Substitute as they finally went for stun spore. Next turn, I tried using Bounce, which didn't kill. Gardenia then tried to heal as we hit an Ice Fang. And on the next turn, Bounce hit again, killing the Blossom. Second was Tangela. So, predicting a Shockwave, we switched to Silas. But they used Stun Spore, which is fine. They're definitely using Grass Knot now, so it's time to switch to Thomas, who easily absorbed the Grass Knot. And with that, Tangela, dead. Breloom, dead. Grottle, dead. Charum took a few turns because of healing, but it eventually died to Signal Beam. Last was Roserade. Psybeam did more than half health, but they used a Citrus Berry, so we won't be able to kill them the next turn. They retaliated with Magical Leaf, and I didn't want to risk a crit this time, so I switched to Joanna. I again reached the point where I needed to risk a crit, but there was nothing I could do but to pray that Bounce doesn't miss, and it didn't. And that's Gardenia. She was much easier than I expected her to be. I deserve to lose a Pokemon there if I'm being honest. After the battle, I evolved Phoebe into Milotic, Priscilla into Lantern, and Nicodemus into Cloyster, whose evolution I delayed because I waited for him to learn Iron Defense. With my Pokemon ready, I took on Jupiter. I led with Priscilla against Golbat and they outsped us with Giga Drain as we retaliated with Discharge. Next turn, they went for Confuse Ray and we hurt ourselves. I then switched to Thomas, who absorbed the Giga Drain and fought back the Golbat, taking it down. Next was the Tangela, and of course it went down too. Third was Sableye, so I switched to Joanna for the Intimidate and began stalling with Nicodemus. I set up 3 Iron Defenses and killed it with a series of Aurora Beams. Last was Skontank. It too died to a series of Aurora Beams as its Night Slashes were just pathetic. After grabbing the secret key in Jupiter's room, I opened the secret area that houses a bunch of appliances. I had Salome the Rotom possess a washing machine, transforming it into Rotomlash and turning its type into Electric and Water. I then went to Orberg City to revive the Helix Fossil given to me in Eterna City. I revived Omanyte, who I named Jude, and he's got the Jolly Nature and the Shell Armor ability. The next battle had a stressful planning stage. Mira's team is composed of special attackers with not that many weaknesses. Going into this battle, I knew that someone in my team could potentially die. So first, I set in Priscilla against Togetic. We absorbed the Dazzling Gleam as 2 discharges killed it. Next was Kadabra, so I switched to Thomas, who can tank anything. And after absorbing a Psybeam, we hit back with Signal Beam, which killed the Kadabra. Third was Porygon 2, the biggest threat of this team so far. I tried switching to Barnabas because I know it can tank a Charge Beam, and oh my gosh, they missed. This allowed me to use Rock Smash on them as they retaliated with Charge Beam. We didn't get the defense drop and they didn't get the special attack boost, so I guess it's good. I then hit them with another Rock Smash, which lowered their defense as they just went for Recover. We again exchange a Rock Smash and Recover until we finally KO the Porygon 2. Last was the Hunter. I went for Aquajet and they went for Curse, bringing Hunter's HP to the red. Expecting a heal, we switched to Thomas and set up a substitute as he just spammed double team. This didn't matter though, because we hit both our attacks, killing the Hunter. And all I could say is that the missed charge beam was insane. Barnabas shouldn't have lived. Our next major battle was against Dawn just before Mount Cornet. I led with John and Pylos Wine died to 3 Scalds after getting the burn and some healing. Clefable was a little tough, but we managed to burn them as Joanna finished it off with Aquatail. Monferno went down to a single Aquatail, and Lopunny died to a crit Dazzling Gleam. Not sure if the crit mattered though, since Phoebe now gets stabbed from Dazzling Gleam. Next was the infamous Eren battle just before Heartholm City, and I've seen many Nuzlocks die to this. So I led with Joanna against Dustox. They stupidly used Protect as we went for Bounce. We didn't miss, so they're one Pokemon down. Second was Venomoth. They outsped and hit us with Sludge Bomb. We used Bounce and it's about time that we miss it. We then survive another Sludge Bomb as Bounce finally hit. Third was a Beautifly and its special attack stat was super buffed in this game. I switched to Phoebe who can absorb an Air Slash and my plan here was to use Captivate to harshly drop its special attack. After absorbing an Energy Ball, we recovered and tanked another Energy Ball. We hit a crit Dazzling Gleam, but they have a Focus Sash, so after Aaron tried to heal, 2 more Dazzling Gleams killed the Beautifly. Fourth was Drapion, so I switched to Nicodemus who can tank anything. I then stupidly used Protect as I went for Swords Dance. We managed to max our Swords Dance and Iron Defense, then we started attacking. I made sure to Protect every other turn to keep us healthy, but on the second attacking turn, Drapion managed to poison us. We eventually killed the Drapion, but our health wasn't enough to deal with the scissor, so I switched to Joanna for the X-Scissor and we managed to live a crit 1 HP. Predicting a bullet punch, we switched to Salome, and then we hit them with Will-O-Wisp as they used Swords Dance. But after a couple of discharges, the Nuzlocke remains at 1 death so far. We definitely escaped too many close calls. In preparation for the Fantina battle, I evolved my beloved Luke into Croconaw and into Feraligatr. I do have some experience in dealing with Fantina in Renegade Platinum before, so I have a good strategy against her. I led with Timothy against her Drifblim. We immediately yawned it to sleep as they set up a Calm Mind. Next turn, I switched to Luke who I know can tank a Shadow Ball. And now that it's asleep, I first set up a Substitute. Next turn, I went for Agility and they remained asleep. I then proceeded to set up a Swords Dance and they're still asleep. I again set up another Swords Dance and never again did Drifblim see the light of day. With plus 4 attack, plus 2 speed, and Substitute as a shield, Drifblim, dead. Miss Magius, dead. Gengar, dead. Spiritomb, dead. Dusclops, dead. Bayonet, dead. The next dry fight was pretty uneventful, so I'm just gonna skim through what happened. Salome Oko the Staravia, Grodel did pose some problems for Joanna and Phoebe, but Thomas managed to damage it severely, allowing Luke to land the finishing blow. When Heracross came out, I kept on switching between Joanna and Luke until its attack stat reached inutility. When I sent in Nicodemus, we set up 3 iron defenses and killed it with a bunch of bubble beams. Snorlax was specially tanky, and Nicodemus couldn't touch it at all, so I switched to Salome, burned it with Will-O-Wisp, and then killed it with a bunch of discharge. I then killed another shiny while grinding. Anyway, Silas evolved into Swampert, and so we face yet another stressful battle. In Renegade Platinum, Team Galactic takes over the Pokemon Mansion, where Saturn and Mr. Backlaw tag teams against me and Dry. Double battles are always hard to play around with, especially in Nuzlockes. You can't control the moves of your partner's Pokemon, and your opponents can just decide to gang up on your own Pokemon. If there's an option for a double battle to become 2 single battles, then I always take that route. But as for this case, this double battle is required to progress through the game. I led with Barnabas against Wigglytuff and Bronzong. I yawned the Bronzong as Wigglytuff just Oko Dry Staravia. Next turn, I used Return on Wigglytuff, triggering the Cute Charm, but both opponents ganged up on Heracross. We're down 2 Pokemon while their team was still complete. Next turn, Barnabas simped for Wigglytuff, but Grodel did its job by revenge killing it. Afterwards, they sent in Espeon, but they protected the first turn. On the next turn, Grodel barely survived Espeon Psychic, and Espeon barely survived a return, allowing Grodel to set up a Leech Seed onto the Bronzong. Then, I immediately killed the Espeon before it could do some damage to Grodel. Grodel also killed the Bronzong with its Crunch and Leech Seed. So, they sent in Toxicroak and Raichu. And this is awkward. Both Toxicroak and Raichu are the biggest threats to both my and Dry's team, and I didn't expect this to happen, so my plans have now been foiled. Next turn, I totally misplayed by switching to Joanna for the Intimidate, whereas I should have predicted that both Raichu and Toxicroak are gonna gang up on Grodel because it's low on health. I really could have killed either of those Pokemon with Barnabas' return. Anyways, I switched between Silas and Joanna to get more intimidates as Dry Snorlax took more and more damage. This continued until I switched to Phoebe, with Snorlax dying to stab Drain Punch. Good thing Snorlax yawned the Toxicroak in the turn before, so it's still a 1v1 as of this point. Phoebe managed to deal more than half health with the Raichu, then I switched to Salome. After exchanging our Thunderbolts and Shadow Balls, I managed to kill the Raichu, but Toxicroak decided to wake up on this very turn, killing Salome in the process. Another misplay was using Shadow Ball instead of Hydro Pump. Next turn, Joanna revenge killed the Toxicroak with Bounce, and Barnabas finished the Octillery with Return. That's 2 deaths so far, and honestly, I never expected us to stay at 1 death for a long time. This death was long overdue, and Salome the Rotom had to take one for the team. With one member leaving the group, 2 more arrived. I caught Elizabeth the Goldeen in Route 209 with a Lax Nature and the Swift Swim ability. And on Route 208, I forgot to catch my encounter here, so I fished for Rhoda the Remoraid with a Timid Nature and the Sniper ability. Soon, I reached Solathion Town, and all I could say is that this is my favorite place in all of Renegade Platinum. Why? That's because you can Eevee train and grind your Pokemon in their daycare. They also sell Eevee reducing berries to remove those unwanted Eevees from your Pokemon. And I love abusing this feature of Renegade Platinum. It makes me feel that I'm playing competitive somehow. After that, I headed northeast to Route 215 where I caught Apollos the Meryl, who has a Lax Nature and the ever amazing huge power ability. And while grinding for the Veilstone Gym, I evolved him into Azumarill and Timothy into Blastoise, who now has the Drizzle ability. And so, we face Meilene. So I led with Joanna against Medicham for the Intimidate. They're gonna use Fake Out, so now's the time to switch to Timothy. They then used High Jump Kick, which would probably kill if it crit, but I used a turn to use Yawn. Back to Joanna for the second Intimidate as Medicham missed High Jump Kick, but the landing crash damage is so cute, I didn't know that. I then used Substitute. But on the following turn, Medicham decided to wake up right away, damaging the sub as they set up a Dragon Dance. Next turn, I set up another Dragon Dance as the Substitute faded. Since a Substitute can take 2 Zen Headbutts, then I kept on using Substitute and Dragon Dance until we reached plus 4 attack. And with that, Medicham dead. Machamp managed to survive with just a sliver as they hit us with Thunder Punch. Next turn they healed, but Earthquake managed to crit, so Machamp dead. Infernape dead. Toxicroak dead. Gallade dead. Lucario dead after breaking its Focus Sash. Joanna with Dragon Dance seriously makes this game easier. But since this is a monotype hardcore Nuzlocke on Renegade Platinum, then I think it's perfectly reasonable not to ban this combo. I mean, we still had to play around a bunch of crits to pull that off. So moving on, I added several more members to my team. On Route 213, I caught a Pelipper, another Pokemon with a Drizzle ability, plus a quirky nature. I named him Paul, because Luwap hates battling rain teams. In Pastoria City, I fished for a Carvana, who's got a careful nature and the speed boost ability. I named him Mark, because Elite Trainer Mark is the ultimate Dark-type specialist. In the Great Marsh, I caught Euodia the Quagsire with a quiet nature and the water absorb ability. And on Route 212, I caught Cintucci the Lombre with a hardy nature and the Swift Swim ability. Like with Gardenia's case, you'll first have to pick up Wake before battling him, so I went all the way to the end of the southern Route 212 as it's practicing his new song. Next, I evolved Mary into Empoleon. And then we have the longest battle so far in this game, with Dry. I led with Paul to set up the rain. Predicting a double edge, I switched to Mary. Then predicting a close combat, I pivoted to Joanna. I did this switch in between Mary and Joanna 2 more times until Seraptor reached minus 3 attack. Afterwards, it's time to do my bidding with Nicodemus. I set up 3 iron defenses that were now virtually unstoppable. And with that, Staraptor, dead. Heracross, dead. Torterra, dead. And then we have Arcanine, who's carrying Heatwave, a special move. But with the help of Protect and Leftovers Recovery, we managed to outlast them and eventually kill the Arcanine. Next was Azumarill, who also died after a very long exchange of attacks. And last was a Snorlax, and this thing has leftovers and rest, so there's no way we could touch them. I tried attacking, but they just kept on recovering, so I switched to Joanna for the Intimidate, then onto Silas. The first Hammer Arm did more than half health, but they rested on the next turn. Despite the annoying paralysis from their Body Slam, we eventually managed to kill them with 2 more Hammer Arms. Before the Wake fight, I evolved Cintucci into Ludicolo, and after that, I immediately battled him. One thing I love about the Pastoria Gym, besides a big brain puzzle, is that in this game, rain is permanent in all of the gym battles. So I led with Thomas to get off an intimidate onto Quagsire. I then switched to Joanna to get off another intimidate. And now, I thought that they're gonna use Ice Punch, so I switched back to Thomas, but I miscalculated that Aqua Tail will actually do more damage because of Stab and Rain, and that was a bad play because we probably would've died to a crit. Finally, I switched back to Joanna and got off the 4th Intimidate. And now, we're gonna do what we always love to do. Set up a substitute, set up 5 Dragon Dances, and Quagsire managed to survive. And no, it doesn't have Unaware. But since I was expecting them to heal, I set up my final Dragon Dance and Quagsire dead. Gyarados dead. Floatzel dead. Ludicolo dead. Poliwrath dead. Sharpedo dead after breaking its Focus Sash. It's basically Meleen all over again. As soon as Team Galactic bombed the Great Marsh, I one-shot this Galactic Grunt's Toxicroak with Earthquake. And it's time to head on to Celestic Town. But just before reaching the town, Dawn challenged me to a battle. I led with Paul against Alakazam for the rain. I remember being too tired to do this battle, so there definitely were a lot of misplays here. I remember going kamikaze and not caring if a Pokemon dies. I switched to Joanna because I thought she could tank a Psychic well. Not really. So I had to risk another crit, which I did, and successfully one-shot the Alakazam with Waterfall. Clefable was a weird one because I'd set in Mary to do some damage, but Dawn decided to switch to Jolteon. So I pivoted to Silas and killed it with Earthquake. Clefable comes back again, and after some exchange of attacks, the same thing basically happened. So now it's Infernape. I went with Paul to eat the close combat, then bait a Thunder Punch onto Silas. With that, we KO'd them with Earthquake. Then came Clefable, so I just two-shot it with Waterfall, and last was Mamoswine. This one's holding a Pasho Berry, which halves the damage of Water-type moves, but I still went for Waterfall, which crit! Last was a Lopunny, and I tried to stay and go for Waterfall, but it was a bad idea because we would've died to a crit there, so I switched to Paul, who Oko'd it with Hurricane. Next was a battle with Cyrus in Celestic Town. I led with Priscilla against his Crobat. Luckily, they missed their Hypnosis, allowing me to hit my first Discharge. The second Hypnosis hit, but we were holding a Chesto Berry, so we just KO'd it with another Discharge. Next was a Magnezone, so I switched to Silas, who tanks everything Cyrus's Pokemon can give us. And with that, Magnezone dead. Hunchcrow dead. Weavile dead. Now that we have access to Surf, I examined the surfing areas and caught my next few Pokemon. On Route 220, I caught Lydia the Mantine, who's got the Quiet Nature and the Swift Swim ability. On Route 221, I caught Susanna the Tentacool with the Liquid Ooze ability and the Serious Nature. And in Fuego Ironworks, I managed to catch this Chalos with a Rash Nature and the Sticky Hold ability. And I named him Andrew. After some EV training and grinding, I challenged Castle Valet Dirac in Paul Park, which I think is an awesome feature in Renegade Platinum. I've seen many people struggle in this fight, but since Dirac's Pokemon are hyper-offensive with not much status gimmicks, this team was easily exploitable. I first sent in Paul against Gallade. We tanked a Psycho Cut as I used Tailwind just in case my other members will need them later. Next turn, we outsped and brought them to red. They healed, but I brought them back to where they came from. And as a Tailwind petered out, I set up another one, absorbing a Psycho Cut and then killing the Gallade on the next turn. Second was a legendary Entei, which by the way was the least threatening member of his team. I just switched to Silas, stole the Protect, and killed it with Waterfall. Third was Alakazam, and I'm glad I caught this specially defensive Lydia the Mantine, who easily absorbed the Energy Ball. We then outsped because of Swift Swim and Tuit KO'd it with Scald. Fourth was Metagross. I switched to Nicodemus to absorb the Zen Headbutt, which missed. Next, I sent in Joanna for the Intimidate. Afterwards, I switched to Nicodemus, who can now easily tank their attacks. So we set up 3 Iron Defenses and killed the pseudo-legendary with a couple of Surfs. His Staraptor also died to a single Aurora Beam, and last was the Empoleon. So I sent in Priscilla, who resists everything they have, and it was only a matter of time until they died to a series of discharges. Upon reaching Canalave City, I immediately battled Dry, whose team is made up of physical attackers, so you probably know what I'm doing this time. I led with Mary the Empoleon, because Staraptor was holding a Choice Band. So I wanted to bait him into using close combat as he switched to Joanna. I then pivoted to Paul to tank an attack, and then back to Joanna for another Intimidate. At this point, I thought Staraptor was now at -5 attack because I stupidly thought close combat reduces attack and defense instead of defense and special defense. So I confidently switched to Nicodemus, who still did a great job at absorbing the hit. After 3 Iron Defenses, Staraptor dead. Heracross dead. Torterra dead. Arcanine dead. And then came Snorlax. You guys know from my past experiences how I couldn't touch the Snorlax. So I switched to Apollos the Azumarill as he set up a curse. If there's something I notice about the AI in this game is that they'd almost always use a setup move if they don't see a kill on one of their attacking moves. I personally don't think they see a kill with Body Slam right now, so I expected them to use another curse. So I went the risky path and used Belly Drum, and they used Curse. So next turn, we Oko them with Super Power. Laz was his Azumarill. So I switched to Mary, who can tank everything, and KO'd it with a bunch of Flash Cannons. I then went fishing in Canalave City and got Lazarus a Staryu with a Naive Nature and a Natural Cure ability. Now, Riley, as we all know, is a stat trainer that specializes in attack. And you guys know how I deal with physical attackers, right? Stack up 6 Intimidates, switch to Cloyster, and use Iron Defense to the maximum, then Sweep. Absol, dead. Lucario, dead. Ursaring, dead. Slaking, dead. Metagross, dead. Salamence, dead. I also fished for my encounter in Iron Island and got Philemon the Quillfish, who's got the Intimidate ability and the Hasty nature. Upon clearing the island, I spoke to Byron, causing him to go back to the gym. And oh my gosh, was Byron as free as he was in the vanilla games. Bronzong is such a weak lead that I managed to set up enough Dragon Dances to sweep his team. Bronzong, dead. Magnezone, dead. Aggron, dead. Steelix, dead. Fortress, dead. Bastiodon, dead. In the library, the old man was just chilling with his 3 grandkids until we hear a doom from the television, reporting about recent bombings in Lake Valor. There, I fought Saturn in order to save the flopping Magikarp. First, I set up Rain with Paul, then switched to Mantine to tank and kill the Alakazam. When Raiden came in, I called Silas for the Oko Earthquake. Joanna had a good battle against Octillery, but we managed to land the finishing blow. For the Bronzong, Luke just resisted everything, so we just set up some Dragon and Swords Dances and killed it along with the Toxicroak. Unlike in vanilla games, Mars in Lake Verity was much easier than Saturn. I led with Timothy to set up Rain as well as kill the Crobat with a couple of Scalds, and next was a Bronzong. Luke was just an awesome Bronzong counter that we managed to set up enough Dragon Dances, so Bronzong, dead. Yanmega, dead. Kangaskhan, dead. Perugly, dead. After traveling all the way north to Snow Point City, I first needed to battle these 2 ace trainers before challenging Candace. People say this is a hard battle, and it was. I led with Paul and Joanna to set up both Rain and Intimidate. First turn, Blissey went down to guys, I'll just go have my lunch in Japan. I'll be back. Okay, that was an amazing launch. The flight wasn't bad either. Anyways, where were we? Oh yeah, next turn, Joanna evaded the rock slide, but Paul was severely damaged by it and Pell Danced, but we doubled in on the Meganium and killed it. I switched Paul to Silas as Joanna once again evaded a rock slide and Oko'd the Heracross with Waterfall, which wasn't the best idea because they now sent in Tyranitar. Silas used Earthquake, damaging the Feraligatr as Tyranitar protected itself. Silas then protected, and Joanna was the one to use Earthquake, which did minimal damage. I switched Silas into Nicodemus, and nothing eventful happened during this time, as we just exchanged our attacks until Joanna's health got to a point that I wasn't comfortable with, provoking me to switch her into Mary. I also switched Nicodemus into Phoebe as Mary killed Tyranitar with Flash Cannon. With Feraligatr and Typhlosion left on the field, we first killed the Feraligatr because Typhlosion used Protect. The problem now is that Typhlosion outspeeds and might be carrying Thunder Punch or Earth Power, and both of those attacks can be detrimental to my team. But I somehow had the gut feeling that Draiano is gonna give this Earth Power, thus programming the AI to attack Empoleon. So I riskfully switched Mary into Paul, and yes, they used Earth Power, which allowed Phoebe to kill the Typhlosion with Scald. In the Snowpoint Temple, I found Maylene and Candace doing some stuff with Regigigas, but the Regi was immovable, so I went back and challenged Candace. No glitches for us though, so we had to smash all the snowballs before getting to her. Unlike the previous 4 gym battles, Candace wasn't someone who'd easily fall into our setup traps, so this battle was a little more complicated. I led Mary to set up Stealth Rocks, which is gonna be super important in this game, as she tanked an Earthquake like a boss. Predicting another Earthquake, I switched to Paul in order to change the weather to rain, as well as kill it with 2 Hurricanes after dodging a crit Blizzard which would've killed us. Candace set in her Frostlass, which is definitely gonna use Thunderbolt, so I switched to Euodia, the Quagsire, who I EV trained in HP and Special Defense by the way. After absorbing a Thunderbolt, we put it to sleep with Yawn, then switched to Luke. I used the first turn to set up a substitute. In the next turn, they immediately woke up and broke our sob, but I managed to set up a Dragon Dance. Now that we're faster, we Oko'd the Frostlass with Crunch, and KO'd the Glaceon with Waterfall after getting a lucky flinch. Forrest was a Walrein as it switched to Phoebe, who absorbed the yawn and used Toxic before falling asleep. They couldn't really touch us, so after a few more turns, Walrein succumbed to Toxic and Moonblast. Next was a Mamoswine, who was carrying a Pasho Berry, allowing it to survive a scald after hitting us with Earthquake. Of course, I wouldn't risk a crit this time, so I switched to Joanna and baited a Stone Edge into Euodia. We managed to tank an Earthquake and hit the final blow. Last was a Weavile, who was holding a Focus Sash, and the main reason why I set up Stealth Rocks. I switched to Joanna as I set up a Swords Dance. And in the final turn, we survived a +2 Icicle Crash and ended the battle with a Rain-boosted Stab Waterfall. I didn't expect Weavile to survive that, but I have Luke, who can easily tank its attacks and truly finish the battle this time. In Lake Acuity, I caught Damarius Decilio, who's got the Ice Body ability and the Hasty nature. I also evolved Lazarus into Starmie in preparation for the infiltration operation in the Galactic Station, where I faced this harmless grunt with a Vespiquen. Except that she had Destiny Bond bringing Silas to the grave with her. I hated this death because Silas had been one of the stars of this team, and for him to die so carelessly to a Galactic grunt is purely injustice. I should have scouted their move first with Protect before doing something stupid. Anyways, at least I do have a bunch of water ground babies to spare, so we welcomed Andrew the Shellos to my team and evolved him into Gastrodon. The Cyrus battle was fun for me because I finally got my hands on a special sweeper in Starmie. I do believe that this exact moveset of Starmie is what made me fall in love with it as a kid. It just looks, I don't know, delicious. Anyways, I led with Timothy against a Crobat. They used U-turn though, so our yawn went to Magnezone. I used Protect to stall a turn before putting it to sleep. At that point, I decided that I'm just gonna stay with Timothy and kill this Magnezone with a bunch of scalds. Probably a bad idea, but Magnezone never woke up, so I guess it was fine in hindsight. Cyrus then sent in his Honchkrow, who paralyzed us with Thunderwave, but we retaliated with yawn. As soon as it fell asleep, I immediately switched to my choice specs Lazarus, and Honchkrow, dead. Oh my gosh, I forgot to switch Starmie's life orb into choice specs? Anyways, Houndoom also died, and next was a Weavile, who would've easily died with choice specs, but it'd be arranged to kill it with life orb, and I don't wanna risk that. I decided to do my old trick and switch Nicodemus, set up some iron defenses, and killed both the Weavile and the Crobat. Saturn was next, and he was pretty easy. Y'all know how I deal with Bronzongs, right? Set up Dragon Dances with Look, and Bronzong, dead. Toxicroak, dead. Rhyperior, dead. Octillery, dead. Magmortar, dead. Alakazam, dead. Before going to Spear Pillar, good old Peter evolved into Seadra and into Kingdra. With that, it's finally time to take on arguably the greatest battle of this game, the 12v12 battle against Mars and Jupiter. I didn't plan for this battle except bringing bulky Pokemon, because I knew that the opponent's Pokemon are almost always tending to attack frailer Pokemon, and I was hoping for them to attack Dry's Pokemon instead of mine. I wouldn't discuss everything that happened here since it's gonna take the entire video for that, but in summary, Dry's Staraptor okoed Mars' Crobat with Brave Bird then proceeded to do the same thing with her Electivire. Jupiter's Crobat avenged her fallen sisters and gave Staraptor a taste of his own medicine, as it got a critical hit Scald against Mars' Bronzong, killing it in the process. Jupiter's Crobat went down to a series of Zen Headbutts from Snorlax as a poison Kangaskhan killed him with Hammer Arms. Dry's Heracross then comes in and okos Mars' Kangaskhan. Next turn, Lydia okoed the Tangrowth with Hurricane as Perugly killed Heracross before he could do another close combat. Azumarill managed to land an Aqua Tail onto Skontank but died to a Gonk Shot and what I think is a Life Orb damage. We almost killed the Perugly, but it was Arcanine who went down first, causing Dry to send out his last Pokemon. Next turn, Torterra finally put an end to the cat with 9 lives as Mars was down to her last Pokemon. So far, this battle has been favorable for us, but I got too excited to finish Mars that I instantly clicked Ice Beam, forgetting that Nicodemus has such a frail special defense stat. And with that, Mars' Yanmega used Hurricane, effortlessly okoing my Shell Armor King. He's been one of the most reliable members of the team, and it sucks to lose him because of a misclick sprinkled with overconfidence. I feel like the deaths in this Nuzlocke are getting dumber and dumber the more they come. Anyways, Torterra then revenge killed the Yanmega with Stone Edge. Now that the battle is at 2v1, Jupiter's Pokemon just dropped one by one like flies. This 12v12 battle was surprisingly easier than I thought since Dry was carrying us all throughout, and I could've gone out with zero deaths, but I guess deaths grounded in stupidity make the game much more interesting, right? Right? Cynthia finally appeared after all this time, and she brought us to the Distortion World. This place had some weird vibe to it, and I felt like something bad was going to happen. There we engaged in our penultimate battle with Cyrus and his Dialga and Palkia. This looks difficult on paper because of the level gap, but our Pokemon are super tanky that I knew they can survive. Right off the bat, Palkia landed a crit Earth Power on Phoebe as she retaliated with Moonblast. As I switched Phoebe to Lydia, Andrew landed the finishing Earth Power on Dialga. I then brought back Phoebe to tank any of Palkia's attacks as I went for Hurricane, forgetting that Rain wasn't set up yet, so that was a lucky 70% chance hit. Another reason I brought Phoebe was to ensure that Palkia doesn't use Spatial Rend on this slot, which allowed me to safely switch into Peter as I also switched Lydia to Paul for the Rain. And with Swift Swim, Peter outsped and killed the Palkia with Dragon Pulse. After the battle, I was already planning on which Pokemon to use in the final battle against Cyrus. And what the heck, I wasn't informed that the next battle happens right away? So I again had zero preparations for this battle, and I didn't bring some of my powerhouses like Gyarados and Feraligatr. What else can I do but to do my best and plan my moves as I go, right? Thankfully, I was leading with Phoebe, baiting a Choice Band Crobat to use Cross Poison as I switched to Mary. With that, Mary effortlessly took it down with Rock Climbs. Next came the Magnezone. I switched to Andrew. Oh my gosh, it had Magnet Pull, which traps Steel types on the field. Mary may have survived the first Thunderbolt and managed to land a Yawn, but the next one was eventually the final nail in her coffin, as I watched my starter Pokemon lay to rest in the abysmal depths of the Distortion World. Andrew avenged his comrade by Okoing the Magnezone with Earth Power. For the Honchkrow, I switched to Paul, who was amazing at surviving a crit Brave Bird bypassing Paralysis and Okoing it with two Hurricanes. Gyarados was scary, because he can set up some Dragon Dances. I switched to Peter to tank the Stone Edge and put it to sleep with Yawn. They did manage to set up two Dragon Dances though, but they never awoke, as Peter used four Dragon Pulses to kill the Gyarados. Next was Weavile, and I first landed a Yawn as they hit us with Feint Attack. They then used Swords Dance before falling asleep, allowing us to KO them with two Waterfalls. And as for the Houndoom, it just died to a single Waterfall. With Cyrus out of the way, we proceeded to beat Satan and finally save the world.
Merry Chrysler!
In the Sand of Spring, I caught this Golduck who I named Persis, and she's got the Cloud9 ability and the gentle nature. I continued my journey east towards Sunnyshore City as recommended by Professor Rowan. In preparation for the Volkner battle, I evolved Damaris the Cilio into Walrein, Martha the Barboach into Whiscash, and Dorcas the Poliwag into Poliwhirl, then into Politoed. Volkner being an electric gym was pretty difficult to plan around. I led with Dorcas against his Jolteon. Thinking they're gonna use either Thunderbolt or Thunder Wave, I opened with Encore. They used Thunderbolt, which meant that I had to survive a crit. I even got paralyzed, but a Cherry Berry healed Dorcas, allowing us to successfully execute the Encore. Now that they're locked with Thunderbolt, I switched to Martha, used a substitute, and set up two Dragon Dances as Encore ended immediately, with Jolteon breaking our sub. After two Dragon Dances, Jolteon still outsped, so they hit us with a Grass Knot, which surprisingly did less than half health. We retaliated with a +2 Earthquake, but Jolteon survived because of Focus Sash. Expecting a heal, I set up another Dragon Dance. They did heal, so on the next turn, we outsped and Okoed the Jolteon. With +3 attack and speed, Rotomwash, dead. Luxray, dead. Electivire, dead. Rotom Heat, dead. Raichu, dead. And that's the final gym leader. I still can't believe that we managed to reach this far into this run. My next expedition was Victory Road, but as I was exiting the cave, this NPC told us to first visit the east section of the Victory Road, which was only accessible in the post-game of Vanilla Platinum. Upon entering the east side, Marley, the speed trainer, immediately challenged us to a battle. I led with Cyntachie against her Starmie. Right off the bat, they crit us with Psychic, but we recovered the damage with Giga Drain. Marley then withdrew her Starmie for the Crobat, so I did the same and switched to Paul. After taking a Brave Bird, we retaliated with Hurricane, which luckily crit. Third was Electrode, which caused me to switch to Martha to absorb the Thunderbolt. I then set up a substitute as they set up their light screen. And with no attacking moves that can hit us, Electrode committed suicide, exploding itself in her substitute. Her next Pokemon was Sceptile, so I switched to Peter, who got hit by a crit Energy Ball. Peter has Ice Beam, which could easily kill the Grass Dragon Sceptile, so I excitedly clicked on the attack. The problem was that I forgot that Light Screen was still in effect, which allowed Sceptile to survive and kill my Peter with Dragon Balls. Marley tried to heal, but my Lazarus Revenge killed the Sceptile with its own Ice Beam. Next came the Weavile, so I switched to Luke. We had to absorb a Low Kick before killing it with a 4x super effective Brick Break, shattering the Light Screen in the process. For the Arcanine, I switched to Lazarus who absorbed the Close Combat, then Okoed it with Surf. Last was Starmie, and despite healing, they died to our Thunderbolt. I exited east of Victory Road, leading us to Route 224, where we partake in our final battle with Dawn. Now that Nicodemus, the Shell Armor Cloyster, is gone, someone had to take over, and it was Jude, the Omanyte, whom I evolved into Omastar. Towards the end of the route, Dawn was waiting for us to engage in our final battle together. I led with Jude against Alakazam. We managed to survive an Aura Sphere and set up a Stealth Rock. Next turn, I switch to Timothy for the rain. We then switch to Dorcas to absorb 2 psychics and use an Encore. With Alakazam locked into psychic, you guys know what I did next. Switch in Luke, set up 4 Dragon Dances before their Encore ended, and Alakazam, dead. Clefable, dead. Jolteon, dead. Lopunny, dead. Infernape, dead. Mamoswine, dead. With Dawn defeated, I can finally exit the Victory Road and reach the Pokemon League. But before challenging the Elite Four and Champion, we still had to battle our main rival, Dry, whose team was still composed of physical attackers. But since I didn't have a Cloyster anymore, this battle was a little more complicated than before. I opened with Jude against a Choice Band and Staraptor to bait a close combat into Philemon the Quillfish, who finally made his debut in his team. After intimidating the Staraptor, I set up 2 layers of Toxic Spikes, then switched back to Jude. I used Protect it once, depleting all of its PP, causing it to use Struggle as we managed to set up 4 with Ross. And Staraptor, dead. Next was Torterra, who can severely damage us. First turn we used Protect, the next turn we killed them with Ice Beam after taking a Wood Hammer. Heracross was next, and we managed to survive with just a Sliver before managing to take it down. Next was my most hated Pokemon on Dry's team. This was a weird case, because initially they were just using Curse as we hit them with a bunch of Power Gems. But after reaching almost half health, they started using Slakoth, but the toxic damage started to overpower the Slakoth recovery. Then I realized that if this continues, there will come a point when Dry will use a full restore on Snorlax, so I knew I had to finish this battle ASAP. I switched to Apollos, but Superpower wasn't enough to KO it. They did use Slakoth again, but Toxic was too much for the big boy. Next was Arcanine. I knew this thing would use Wild Charge, so I had to sack one of my Pokemon. And unfortunately for Apollos, it was his time to go. Or not. Azumarill was last. After almost killing Joanna with a crit play rough, it was Paul who eventually landed the finishing blow. Unlike in the vanilla games, the Elite Four and Champion of Renegade Platinum each have 4 different teams that will be randomly chosen as soon as you enter the league. This means I had to come up with the best possible team that would maximize my chances of beating 20 varying teams, 5 of which would be given to us. It was extremely difficult to narrow it down to just 6 Pokemon, because most of my Pokemon who are still alive each offer unique characteristics that will help us cover a ton of ground. But after some intense and unbiased planning, these were the 6 Pokemon chosen by yours truly to bravely conquer the odds and beat what I think is the first ever hardcore Nuzlocke on Pokemon Renegade Platinum using only a monotype team. Jude the Master, His Hazardous Highness, with max HP and defense and a move pool of Power Gem, Stealth Rock, Withdraw, and Protect. Lydia the Mantine, the Special Sergeant, with max HP and special defense and a move pool of Scald, Hurricane, Signal Beam, and Roost. Timothy the Blastoise, the Drizzling Emperor, with max HP and special defense and a move pool of Scald, Yawn, Protect, and Iron Defense. Damaris the Walrein, the Encore Goddess, with max HP and special defense and a move pool of Surf, Ice Beam, Toxic, and Encore. Luke the Feraligatr, the Dragon Dancing Lancer, with max HP and defense and a move pool of Waterfall, Crunch, Earthquake, and Dragon Dance. And finally, Lazarus the Starmie, the Glass Cannon Star, with max speed and special attack and a move pool of Surf, Psychic, Thunderbolt, and Ice Beam. This is it, champs. Let us go all in and pray that these 6 amazing Pokemon are gonna break through all the obstacles and bring us the title of Pokemon Renegade Platinum Champion. First was a Bug Lover, Aaron. His lead was Masquerain, which means that he was using Team 3, the very team where I needed the help of Stealth Rock because he had a Beautifly with Focus Sash. First, Masquerain hit us with a Stab Hydro Pump, bringing us to more than a third of our HP, as Jude set up the Entry Hazard. Next, I switched to Timothy in order to set up the Rain, which is pivotal for this fight. Third step was to pivot to the Swift Swim Lydia, who can tank anything that Masquerain can bring. And with that, we started sweeping. Masquerain, dead. Heracross, dead. Drapion was a weird case. Scald brought it to the red, but I retaliated with a Sniper boosted Crit Poison Jab, which brought Lydia to 8 HP. I got a little sweaty there, but I did the calcs, and I'm pretty sure we always live that attack. Lydia then finished it off with another Scald, and out came Dustox. We first roosted just to be safe, as their Sludge Bomb didn't poison us. We then went for the attack, and Dustox, dead. Beautifly, dead. Scizor, dead. Second was Mother Earth herself, Bertha. Her lead was Hippowdon, which wasn't what I wanted. Tyranitar would have been better for us because I could just bait a Choice Bandit Crunch. But anyways, after sending Lazarus, I immediately switched to Timothy to change the weather into rain. We used Yawn on the first turn as Timothy just ate all its stacks. I then switched to Luke as it damaged us with Earthquake and fell asleep at the end of the turn. During the sleeping turns, I first set up a substitute, but as soon as it went for my first dragon dance, Hippowdon immediately awoke and broke the sub with Earthquake. But it's fine because a plus 1 rain boosted stab waterfall was enough for the kill. Focus Sash Golem was the next Pokemon, and while it hit us with Thunder Punch, we KO'd them with a couple of waterfalls. We probably could have played that better by setting a Stealth Rock, but I was mostly planning against a Tyranitar team that I low-key forgot about Focus Sash Golem. Anyways, with no major threats in the way, Dunphan, dead. Rhyperior, dead. Whiscash, dead. Gliscor, dead. Third was the fiery Flint. His lead was Ninetales, which could be good or bad for us, depending on which one he sends out next. On the first turn, Ninetales immediately used a powerful 4x super effective Solar Beam, but Jude was holding a Focus Sash, which allowed him to live and set up Stealth Rocks. Next turn, I switched to Timothy to change the weather to our favor. After absorbing a pathetic Solar Beam, we used Yawn, then Protect, and watched them go in their deep slumber. On the first leaping turn, I switched to Lazarus, who took down the Ninetales with Surf. Flint then sent in a Magcargo, which tells me that this team was the one with a Drought Charizard, meaning that instead of just sweeping this battle, things got a little more interesting. Anyways, Magcargo, dead. Then came the Charizard. I went back to Timothy to summon the rain as we tanked a powerful Dragon Pulse. We then put them to sleep with Yawn. On the first leaping turn, I switched back to Lazarus. Surf couldn't get a kill, but good thing they remained asleep. Not that I'm worried since I have a Focus Sash. And after Flint tried to heal, we just landed a crit and Charizard dead. Arcanine dead. Magmortar dead. Lopunny dead. Fourth was a big brain Lucian. He always loves to lead with dual screeners, so I sent in Damaris against his Espeon. Espeon made the fatal mistake of using Light Screen on the first turn as we locked him into using it in a few more turns with the Encore. This allowed me to switch the look and set up 4 Dragon Dances before the Encore ended. At this point, it was too late for Lucian as my Feraligatr was just too powerful for him to handle. With that, Espeon, dead. Medicham, dead. Exeggutor, dead. Gallade, dead. Girafarig, dead. Starmie, dead. Only one trainer stands before me in the title of Sinnoh Champion. The time has finally come to finish this amazing game and end the year 2021 with a banger. Bring it on, Cynthia. Show me what the champion of Renegade Platinum is truly made of. She led with Milotic as I sent out Damaris. Like Lucian, Cynthia fell on her traps and used Light Screen as I locked them with Encore. On the next turn, I did my old trick of switching to look and managed to set up 5 Dragon Dances. But despite the plus 5 attack, Earthquake still wasn't enough to Oko. Now is a good time to set up my final Dragon Dance, but I instead went for Earthquake in fear that Milotic might just decide to burn us with Scald. But Cynthia went for Heal as the Earthquake brought it to red again. Next turn, Cynthia smartly switched to Staraptor as my Earthquake did nothing. Again, it was another opportunity to set up Dragon Dance. Staraptor did succumb to a crunch as Cynthia then sent in her Ampharos. Ampharos was holding a Shuka Berry, which halves the attacks of ground-type moves. But despite that, I firmly believed that Earthquake was gonna Oko. But no! Ampharos managed to live by a sliver as he used the Focus Blast, which of course missed. My next move was probably the worst move that I did. Since it's now the champion fight, I started playing recklessly. Thinking they're gonna heal, I somehow decided to set up another Dragon Dance, which was totally unnecessary. Ampharos landed a Focus Blast as I watched the life of beloved Look slowly ebbing away into nothingness. Look managed to survive with just 1 HP, killing Ampharos on the following turn. Cynthia then sent in her Lucario, which is a priority move Vacuum Wave. And I didn't want to sacrifice Look. He deserved to live after all that happened. I switched to Timothy to set up the rain, then pivoted to Lydia. Lucario couldn't touch Lydia at all, so Lucario dead. Cynthia finally sent her ace Garchomp, and I know that they'll be using Stone Edge. But at this point, I couldn't risk anything, so I called for Scald, hoping for the burn, which we didn't get as Garchomp used a super effective Stone Edge, which crit and killed Lydia. But we still have a battle to finish, so I sent in Lazarus. Since Garchomp was holding a Yachi Berry, Ice Beam didn't kill. They retaliated with Outrage, but Lazarus was holding a Focus Sash, so all is well as Garchomp went down to another Ice Beam. Next was a Spiritomb, so I switched to my other special tank, Damaris. I called for Toxic in the first turn, and after exchanging more attacks, it was Spiritomb who went down. Last was the Milotic. Expecting a full restore, I hit them with Toxic. Milotic only has Scald and Ice Beam as attacking moves, so we easily walled them as a series of serves plus the Toxic damage was too much for them. And with that, we finally beat a hardcore Nuzlocke on Pokemon Renegade Platinum using only Water-type Pokemon. This run has been a blast. Water is my favorite type, and I love that I got to use a bunch of them in this game. I love how Renegade Platinum balanced the viability of many Pokemon, giving a niche to the forgotten ones. It's awesome to see Pokemon like Masquerain and Mantine, who I don't normally see in people's teams, excel in various areas of the game. Intimidate, paired with Shell Armor, is such a solid and reliable strategy that basically walls all the physical attackers. Yawn, Encore, Substitute, and Dragon Dance are downright S-tier support moves, and I'm definitely considering banning at least Dragon Dance in my vanilla game playthroughs. I would say that Gyarados is a true MVP of this run, proving to be a useful Intimidator and Dragon Dancer. Too bad I had to replace her with Feraligatr by the end because I needed that psychic immunity in case something happens with Lucian. I'm truly happy with how this run came out, and I thank each and every one of you for watching my videos and for bringing me to where I am today. Like, I never thought I'd reach more than 2,000 subscribers in the first 7 months of my YouTube journey. I'm really excited for what 2022 brings us as we try to do more hardcore Nuzlockes just like this. To give you a clue, the first Nuzlocke of 2022 will feature one of my favorite characters in the entire Pokemon franchise. And no, it's not Harrison. But it's a Nuzlocke you don't want to miss. And if you have any cool suggestions, feel free to comment them down below. Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year to y'all champs in the making! Enjoy the holiday season and become the most powerful trainer in the world! Thanks for watching, and gotta catch ya in 2022.